And here we are. Welcome to the concluding episode of our journey through BMW Motorsport's past and present, alongside our specialist, their recently retired Chief of Powertrain Design. In this finale, we bring you a quick fire walkthrough of BMW's championship winning cars, pinnacles of motorsport history known for their groundbreaking technology and performance. Step into the world of these remarkable machines with us as we highlight their journey from innovative concepts to esteemed legends of the racetrack.
Maybe the V12 LMR.
Yeah, so it's the LMR, yeah.
Did you ever go to Le Mans?
Really not.
No,
I never
really.
Maybe next year, don't know.
Yeah.
Maybe next year we are in WEC and so I think there's opportunity.
Yeah,
okay, should. So here, for example, this is one of the Pro Car series. The grid was a Formula One grid, the spectators of Formula One were there.
Yeah.
There was a Formula One racers at least, and because it was not such a serious competition like Formula One, the racers were absolutely happy to do that, and they were absolutely brilliant racers. This one here is quite interesting as well. This is a Group 5 car of a 320 BMW of 1978, I guess, something like that.
Yeah.
And it used first Formula 2 engine inside, so 2 liters with around about 320 horses. Then Porsche had an idea to, because in the rules it was written there is a factor, root 2, 1.414, between turbo and normal aspirated engines. And
it's like a performance balance.
Yeah, exactly, yes. Yeah. And so he reduced the displacement to 1.4 liters and added a turbo lader.
Okay.
Turbocharger. And immediately they had more than 500 horses. This was absolutely amazing. And this was the idea, well, okay, if we have 1.4 liter and 500 horses with 1.5 liter, even a little bit more, then we can go to Formula One with that. And this is in this engine, there was the M1212 engine inside, and that was the father more or less of the M1213 for Formula One.
Okay. Mm.
And for sure the LMR, that was a winning car of 1999 with a P75 12-cylinder engine
one
inside.
One of my favorites for sure.
Yeah, it's absolutely a nice car.
Yeah.
And in my opinion, it's looking so simple.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a car, it's a big engine.
Some kind of relatively simple aerodynamics for today. Nothing too complicated.
But it worked. At that time, there were some other cars existing which were more airplanes instead of cars.
I always liked the designs which had the diffuser, the wing so low and close to the diffuser. It looks nice, but it also seems like a very efficient way of, you know, getting air out from under the car. And I've never had a chance to do any analysis on anything like that, but it seems very good.
Well, and besides that, that is a winning car of Bruno Spengler of 2012 in DTM.
Yeah.
At least, and this was quite exciting as well, because we stepped into the competition and won it immediately against very, very hard competitors like Audi and Mercedes. Mm.
Yeah, I think I saw, maybe, I don't know if it was this year, maybe just after, but I saw this at the Nürburgring.
Yeah.
And I just remember the sound. They were just so loud.
Yeah.
I guess this is the four cylinder.
No, this is it depends when you have been there. I think up to 2018 it's what, 8-cylinder engine.
Okay.
And from 2019 and 2020 we drove with a 4-cylinder engine.
So maybe it was the 8-cylinder. Hmm. But because I think it would have been around 2014, 15, but it would have been flat plane V8.
Yes.
Yeah, and I just remember the noise. It was just so loud and.
Yeah, there is a kind of silencer in, but it's quite small. You have the exit left and right hand side of the car. There's a kind of catalytic inverter behind and a small common silencer was given by the Ulrich. That's it.
Yeah. I think it's a real shame to lose this class of DTM.
Yeah, it was more or less a prototype car, you know. Completely, there's a monocoque, you have the engine in front, okay, gearbox at the rear side, gearbox directly bolted to the monocoque and keeping the complete suspension. The engine in front was a part of the structure as well, also there's a kind of a subframe.
Yeah, these were, I mean, although they look quite similar to the road car, this is just a shell on a very, very
more
custom
or less,
chassis.
Yes.
Yeah. This is a cool project.
Yeah.
You put the V12 from...
The V12 Le Mans engine inside BMW X5, especially prepared to more than 700 horses, and then they did a record a lap on the Nürburgring with that.
Yeah.
I think Hans Stuck was driving the car and he told later it was quite funny if you're going to overtake a Porsche with such big car.
Yeah, this is. I guess this is before the Nürburgring trend or craze started as well, right?
Yeah,
it was quite unique.
Yeah.
And then this, probably one of my favorite GT cars ever.
Yeah, that is a set 4 GT3 car. This is powered with a P65 engine.
Yeah.
In the road car, there were only 6-cylinder inline engines in, but here we could use, out of the BMW engines, the S65 engine. This is usually inside the BMW M3 mm-hmm. at that time.
Yeah.
And it was modified to following the GT3 regulations, at least, and in the end it was an absolute brilliant, nice car. It's so small, so tiny, and the sound was so perfect, and it was quite quick, and nice to the driver loved it.
Yeah, no, I can imagine. Really nice. And yeah, as you said, the sound, probably the best sounding GT car to this day, maybe ever.
With the sound, we have got some problems, you know, because you have special rules from track to track.
So in
Nürburgring, you may not exceed 130 dBs, in Spa 110, and we had special exhaust system, and in UK, for example, at 3. We had special exhaust systems for all the different tracks, at least. And it was quite tricky, because sometimes you are absolutely close to the limit.
Wow. Okay. I think that concludes our tour in the museum.
Okay.
Nice.